Hello everyone, my name is Colby Brown and we are here for the third video series with B&H talking about landscape photography. Now in this video, we're gonna talk about the workflow process, subject selection, picking good and bad compositions, and talk about different types of exposure and when to use filters. We got a lot to cover. We're here at beautiful Dingman Falls. There's a lot to see, so let's go ahead and get started. Now the first thing I do anytime I come across a new scene is I work through my five-step process to help me figure out the best way to start when it comes to looking for the most engaging image possible that I can take. Now starting off with number one is we try to identify exactly what is our subject. What is the hero of the story I'm trying to tell here? Now here at Dingman Falls, we have a lot of things that we can focus on. We can focus on the waterfall itself, how the water is cascading down the rocks. We can focus on the reflected light of the waterfall reflecting in the pools below. We can talk about the greenery, how much the water is moving. For me personally with this scene, I really love the reflected light and how it adds a bit more to the composition, which is actually step two in terms of our process. So if we've identified the fact that we love the reflecting light pools of the water cascading down here, then I really want to make sure that I use a composition that emphasizes that choice of subject matter, which was our first step. So in step two, we're trying to figure out what exactly is that composition that's going to make sure that subject matter stands in the best light possible, pun intended. So in this case, that's generally going to mean that we're going to shoot in a vertical orientation and we're going to go pretty wide. I want to use some of the rocks happening below here in my foreground, using the light reflecting off the waterfall, filtering up into the waterfall itself, going back up here, creating some leading lines in the process, which essentially allow the viewer to kind of workflow the scene and to try to get a better idea of exactly what they're looking at. It's a great way in order to give the viewer a bit more direction when it comes to the types of images that you're trying to create and where you exactly want the viewer to look. Now for our third step in this workflow process, we're going to talk about exposure, which means choosing the right ISO, shutter speed, and aperture. Now anytime we're shooting landscape work, we really want to keep our ISO down to 100, which gives us the cleanest colors and the best details in terms of the midtones that we're focused on. So we're going to stick to ISO 100. When it comes to aperture, depth of field isn't super important here because we want to shoot ultra wide as I talked about before. So I want to pick an aperture that's somewhere around f8 to f11, which is typically the sharpest range when it comes to aperture for most landscape-based lenses. Now when it comes to shutter speed, things get a little bit more interesting because I really want to have a longer shutter speed even though we're shooting during the day. Because what it's going to do is it's not only going to allow for the water falling off the waterfalls to look a bit smoother and almost dreamlike, but it's going to smooth out the reflections happening in the water and the pools below, giving us a bit better of an overall look for the types of image that I'm going for. Now for our fourth step in this workflow process, it really comes down to removing distracting elements. What I really want to do is make sure that I get as much right in the field as I possibly can so I can spend less time post-processing, which is actually the last and final part of this video series that we're going to be working on soon. Now, regardless, out here at Dingman Falls, I'm going to be shooting wide, as we talked about before, in a vertical orientation, trying to get the reflected light from the water of the falls reflecting below, and a lot of the natural framing of the forest around Dingman itself. But I want to make sure to pay attention to the frame edges so that there's not distracting elements such as broken branches or trees, or maybe even leaves happening down here in the foreground. If I can safely remove them, I definitely want to do so, just so I have less work on the post-processing side of things. Now for our last and final step, it's actually quite simple. We simply want to take the photo itself. Oftentimes after working through that workflow process, you're going to make changes along the way to try to dictate the direction that you might end up going for your final image. But regardless, you want to take the image, review exactly what you got, and make any necessary changes when it comes to exposure, composition, or even subject matter so that you can come away with the best possible image at the end of the day. Now, one of the biggest pitfalls that you want to typically avoid when it comes to landscape photography is becoming an anchor. And what that means is that you find a composition that you like and you just simply sit on it and photograph the same scene over and over. Now, teaching workshops around the world that focus on landscape photography, I see this quite often because photographers will find that composition that they like and then simply sit down on it and shoot literally the same shot for over an hour, sometimes maybe even two, coming away with hundreds of the same image with slightly variance changes in light. Personally, I recommend that you learn to work the scene, which means that you find a composition that you like, take a couple shots with it, maybe even revisit it, but look around to see what else actually attracts your eye. Now, when I came across this scene with Dingman Falls, the first thing that caught my eye was that reflected water coming off the pools below. But after I got that, I want to mix things up a little bit. and maybe change into the horizontal format to photograph some things with my wide-angle lenses, zooming in a little bit more into the falls itself. Again, using that natural framing of the forest around Dingman Falls itself to create, again, more of a unique image. Now, regardless, when I come across a scene like this, I typically want to come away with 5 or 6 different compositions that really try to emphasize that choice of subject matter, creating some unique opportunities in the process. This process should be naturally evolving, almost organic, as I work through the scene, figure out what works and what doesn't, and try new things so that ultimately at the end of the day, especially if I got good light, I have much more images to workflow in the post-processing stage than that one image just because I sat there for a couple hours taking the same shot over and over. So anytime you're photographing water, the most important element when it comes to exposure is your choice of shutter speed. Now, shutter speed allows you to control the feeling of tension within the image that you're trying to take, specifically when you're photographing water. If you use a fast shutter speed, you can kind of freeze water in time, creating almost like a moment frozen. Whereas if you use a long shutter speed, you can create more of a dreamlike look. Now, truth be told, in most water scenes out there, I like a little bit of both. So oftentimes, depending on the speed of the water that I'm photographing, I'm gonna shoot for sometimes a 0.4 or maybe even 0.6 second shutter speed because that gives me the perfect balance between tension and motion that I wanna convey. I still want that water to feel like it's moving, but I don't necessarily wanna freeze it in time. I wanna give it a little bit more of that dreamlike look. Regardless, make sure that you choose the right shutter speed for the type of scene that you're trying to go for because it can drastically change that feeling of tension within that shot you're trying to capture. When it comes to landscape photography, there's a handful of techniques that are worth learning about, but that in practice don't always apply to every scene out there, such as being out here in Dingman Falls. Now, the first one worth mentioning is photographing panoramas. Panoramas are essentially scenes that are ultra wide, allowing you to capture more of a scene by shooting vertical images and stacking them one on top of each other as you move parallel across a given scene. Now, in comparison, focus stacking is essentially taking the same scene and using different focal points in order to blend those images together to create a scene with larger depth of field. When you use an ultra wide angle lens and you get really close to a foreground subject, you can't get the entire scene in focus. So you need to make sure that you're focusing on that foreground. Maybe the next image you're gonna focus a couple inches up in your frame and a couple inches up. And then you can use software such as Photoshop in order to blend those images together to give you much larger depth of field within that shot. Now, lastly, it is important to talk about HDR images, which essentially stands for high dynamic range. Essentially, high dynamic range images are essentially the idea you take bracketed images, which means images at different exposures of the same scene, and then use post-processing in order to bring out all those details between your shadows, your midtones, and your highlights. Now, with camera technology improving and sensors getting better, I find myself using HDR less and less these days. But every once in a while, there is a scene that has such high contrast, which means they have darker blacks and lighter lights, which means essentially that I need to take a bracketed image set and then combine those images to balance out that exposure in post-processing. Now, as I said before, these techniques are great to know, but it's important to know when to use them, which is why we're not actually using them out here at Dingman Falls because the scene doesn't actually call for it. Regardless, it's worth practicing each of these different techniques so that you're ready when the scene actually calls for it so you can create some pretty amazing images out there. Now, if I had to give you one tip when it comes to landscape photography, it would be to learn how and when to use filters as well, which we talked about in our second video. Now here, this particular scene, I love using both polarizing filters to help cut that reflected light, as well as using neutral density filters to slow down my shutter speed. In a scene like this, using that polarizer can make a huge difference when it comes to enhancing that reflected light coming off that surface of the pool below the waterfall, giving you a much better, a much more interesting composition in the process. Regardless, learning how to use those filters will make a huge difference in your landscape photography. And that's a wrap. What a beautiful day photographing out here at Dingman Falls. Now, so far we've covered the introduction to landscape photography. We've talked about the different cameras, lenses, and accessories that you might need. And I've walked you through the workflow process of what it's like being out here in the field, choosing your subject matter, your composition, and your exposure. Now, for our final video, we're gonna be talking about the post-processing side of things, where I can take all that information, all of that knowledge, and all the images that I've captured, and try to create something unique. Hope you guys enjoy watching, and I'll see you guys soon.